you guys can go ahead and sit down. We're gonna let the choir come up. This is the hardest part. We're trying to get ourselves back up and running, which we are under the wonderful direction of Craig York. Craig York and I went to college together. We were at Western Michigan University together. Very close. We did a lot of arranging for some of the groups down there. Which one of you think is older? From Forest Hills, Northern. He was the choir director there for how many years were you there? 39 years. Couldn't quite make it to 40 years. Anyways, it's been great to have with the choir. We practice Monday nights. If you want to, we got a few people up here singing with the choir. You can see from the barn, and they travel all the way downtown Grand Rapids to be a part of that. And we've got a great year plan, so you can guess. We're going to do one of the tunes that we've been working on. Heather Craig has been with us a number of years. 9 years now? I guess. Yeah. 10?
I actually think it's more like 14 or 15.
14 or 15. Well, which one of us is older? No, this is a great tune. This is, he's an on-time guy, and we're going to share that with you.
Thank you. good?
Yep.
Okay. Great music, man alive. Reminds me of the old days at the evening service of Beaver Dam CRC, doesn't it? Everybody showed up. Someone roller skated, you know, that's good. Thanks, guys. Man, it's been great. Great to have the choir. Yeah, 39 years. That's nothing. Well, here we are. Welcome to y'all, newbies especially. As soon as you cross the threshold of the open door, you're not a newbie anymore. So glad you're here. Nobody's here by accident. Everybody's here on purpose, except Nancy. She's not here yet, but she's not at Mary Freeman either. She's at Billy's 3-bit. I told her she wouldn't probably get the care that she had downtown, and she agreed. That would be true. But we're making do. We're getting around. She actually, I'm going to tell them this, sorry. She wanted to take a shower today. Hadn't taken a shower because of weakness. They showered her, but she wanted to. I said, well, you don't have as much help as you had downtown. So I'm going to give you some incentive. Take care, okay? If I hear something funny going on in there, I'm going to come in and fish you out of that bathtub. What do you think of that? She said, that will be plenty of incentive. Recovering, she's a lot sicker than me, but she's coming along little by little, and soon we'll take the cover off that other keyboard. And Kevin brought her home 58 years to the day from when we brought him home from the same hospital. I don't think it was the same doctor. Well, let's pray. We're going to hear some more music here pretty quick. Lord, thank you, thank you, thank you. It's good to be back in the barn here again tonight. We didn't expect to be here that long, but that's okay. We're glad we could worship you above everything else. And we do that. We lift our hearts and our voices to you again tonight. And we pray for Kevin as he feeds us the good meat and potatoes from your word that we will be ready to chew and swallow what he has to say. So thank you. Thank you, and we bless you in Jesus' name, your son. Amen.
Amen. We're going to continue to worship. We do a mix of music, some old, something new, some borrowed, something blue, as they said. This is a great song, Raised in the Gardens. One of our members passed away recently.
Thank you.
like to feature our recent members to the choir. Whether they want to be so we're very excited. Cindy's joined us all the way from Muskegon. So his eyes on the sparrow, we've done it here before, but let's let her start it and then you guys join with us.
Thank you.
Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, I thank you for these songs, the way in which they lay the foundation, so to speak, for what is about to come. I thank you for the truth that we sang and how it ministers to our minds and to our hearts and to our souls. And I pray, Father, that contrary to the message that we would hear all around us today, that we would begin to think deeply on you, the source of all life, the creator of all things, the giver of all things, the sustainer of all things. And that we would acknowledge that, and not only acknowledge it, that we would hold tightly to that. And even though everything around us is telling us to move away from you, I pray, Father, that you will this night stir our hearts. We don't talk like that much anymore, Father, I know that. But I pray that you will stir our hearts. I pray that as we live our lives, that you will take the cold, that you will take the stiff, the unmovable part of that of our lives, Father, and I pray that you will begin to stir. I pray that our prayers will be warm once again. I fear that many of our prayers in our Christian walk have grown cold to the touch, Father, and I pray that as the result of this night's service, that you will have stirred our lives once again. I pray that we will look for that. I pray that we will long for that. I pray, Father, that we will take in very simple faith the words that you have given to us in your word, and that we will take hold and apply them and put them deeply, deeply in our lives. Let them begin to change and affect who we are. I thank you for the passage that we're going to be looking at here tonight, God. I pray that as we look at these words and as we look at the truths that are here before us, I pray that we will once again wonder at your amazing grace. I pray that we will be moved, Father, stirred once again by the great truths that are found in your word. We just sang about it. Our hearts and minds are prepared for it. And now, Father, as we read and as we study this passage here tonight, I pray that you will open our eyes to you. Let us see you a little more clearly as the result of this, our study here tonight. And we ask all of these things as we always do, Father, in the beautiful and precious, strong, foundational name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. For those who are perhaps first-timers, we have been working our way through the letter that Paul wrote to the Ephesian church. We are in chapter 2, and we're looking fairly carefully at some of the words and ideas that are here. And so if you have your Bibles, I would ask you to turn to chapter 2 of the book of Ephesians. I'm going to read from verse 11 to the end of the chapter, and I want to do that so that we can set the context once again, not only for those who are new and have not been a part of the study, but to remind us of the verses that we looked at over the last couple of weeks. I wish we had time to go back and read the entire first chapter and the first 10 verses of chapter 2, but we're not going to take the time to do that here tonight. I just want to pick up in verse 11. Listen to this letter as I read, and then we'll go back and look at it a little more carefully. Paul says, "Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done the body by the hands of men. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace. And in this one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. And I'm reminded of what Mr. McCarthy would say years and years ago at the church I grew up in. He would say, "And may God add his richest blessing to the reading of the word." Huh? And may God add his richest blessing to the reading of his word. Now let's go back. I want to look at a couple of words in this passage. Last time we were together, we began looking with verses 14 and we went to verse 18. But I want to go back in that section because we really focused on a couple of words, and there's a couple of more that I really want to look at before we move on. The first one I want to look at, I'm going to begin reading in verse 14, but the first word I want to look at and talk briefly about is found in verse 15. Look what it says. It says, "For he himself is our peace." And that's the word peace that we looked at length last time we were together. It says, "Who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility." How? "By abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations." And now he tells us what his purpose was. He says his purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace. Last time we looked at peace, but I want to look very briefly at the idea of making. The peace that was made is something that is assured. The peace that was made is not something that God says, "I hope that these people get it after a time or two, after a year or two, and begin living in peace." When it says that God, through his Son Jesus Christ, made that peace, when it says it was made, it is a done deal. It is a done thing. Let me remind you that there is absolute perfect peace within the church, the body of Christ. There is absolute perfect unity in the church, the body of Christ. Perfect love, perfect joy, perfect everything. All of it is perfect. We just haven't found it yet. We have not achieved it yet. That's why over and over in the Word of God we are told to aim toward that. Strengthen the grace that is within you. Focus on these things. Set aside everything that hinders and pursue. Now that our eyes have been opened, now that we have Jesus Christ as our Savior, and we have been reconciled to God, now that these things have happened, now is the time that we begin to pursue these things. When it says that he made peace through the cross of Jesus Christ, that peace was perfectly made. It's perfect peace. Perfect unity. What gets in the way is the human nature. What gets in the way is the old nature. The flesh is what the Bible calls that. And it gets in the way. Ideally, you and I, as members of the church, the body of Christ, there would be perfect peace, there would be perfect unity, there would be perfect joy and perfect love. Because that is what the church, the body of Christ, is. Remember the time frame we talked about a long time ago, where God does not see things in the here and now. He sees things from end to end, from infinity to infinity, and he sees them perfectly as they are created. And he created the church, the body of Christ, and he created it perfectly. And he removed all the hostility, took down all the barriers, and created his church in absolute perfect peace. And so when the passage says that thus making peace, that peace is there. It is real, it is assured, and it is not to be neglected. The peace now that you and I, as members of the church, are to pursue, now that our eyes are open, we are to pursue the peace that is found in the church, the body of Christ. And it says, in this body, to reconcile both of them to God through the cross. I'm going to talk just a little bit more about both of them and what that is. My daughters play a game with their horses. They learned it from a friend of ours down in Alabama. And the game is called Polo Cross. And Polo Cross is a beautiful combination of the game of lacrosse, which is played with a racket, like with a net, and the game of polo, which is on horseback with a long stick with a mallet on the end. And so what this group has done years and years ago is they have taken these two separate games, they have merged them together, and they have created, removing the other two, and they have created a brand new game, and it's called Polo Cross. Which means that a guy with a lacrosse racket could show up at a polo cross tournament and he would be left behind because he would not be on horseback. And another person could show up on their horse with a mallet and they would be left behind because they don't have the racket. Both of those were individual sports by themselves. Both of them still exist. But the new game of polo cross has been taken of the two and the creation of one new game. And that's exactly what is being talked about here when Paul talks about the one new man. It is not the remake of anything old. It is not someone who has tried to purify their lives and try to remove all the things that are over here. It is someone who has come to Christ through trust in what he did on the cross of Calvary and has become, through that faith, a brand new creature. The Lord Jesus in Luke 11 tells us about the individual that tries to purify his own life. You remember the story of the man who had the evil spirit, and the spirit was removed, and it wandered around in the desert for a long time, and then it came back, and it found the house clean and well kept. And so it went back and got seven other spirits more wicked than itself, and brought it in and took up residence once again within that body. And the state of that individual was then worse than what it was in the beginning. You can attempt to do what is right. You can attempt to do that which is good. But without being a Christian and without the power of the Spirit of God, your attempts are eventually going to fail. And that's the problem with many people. They try and do what's right. And they try and do this. And they try and do that. And it absolutely fails. After a period of time, some longer than others, some shorter than others, but in time, that effort is going to fail. Why? Because they do not have the Spirit of God. When Paul speaks of one new man, he's taking out of the one and taking out of the other and creating in himself, Jesus Christ says, one new man out of the two. And with that one man now, it says, we are now reconciled to God through the cross. One word on reconciliation, just so that everybody's on the same page. The Bible never speaks of God being reconciled to man. The Bible never speaks of God turning his back on creation, where mankind is over there and God says, you know what, I had it, that's enough. God has never done that. His eye is constantly on mankind. His eye is constantly on his creation. It is mankind that has turned our backs on him. We're the ones that move this way. But what Jesus Christ tells us right here in chapter 2 is that out of the Gentile and out of the Jew, God has taken and he has created in himself one new man out of the two and has reconciled that man, that humanity, that church, that body of Christ has reconciled it to God. Which means now, through Christ and the cross, I am now looking at God, and God is looking at me. The verses that we've been looking at, that's just kind of a foundation of where I want to get to now in moving into verse 18, where it says, for through him, that is Jesus Christ, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Have you ever taken the time to think about what it would be like to not have access to God? Maybe there are those in this room who do not have access to God. Maybe you've been attempting to be church-like all your life, and you really don't know what it is to be a child of God, to have access to God. But those who have, when's the last time you thought about what it would be like not to have access to God? To go through this life without hope, without God, wondering what might happen next, looking in the future and being terrified of what's going to come, and doing everything that we possibly can in order to remain here because we have no hope and no relationship with God. And this is exactly the position of those who are outside the church, the body of Christ. We as children of God have access to him, which means day or night, no matter what time of day, no matter what time of night, no matter what the circumstances are, no matter what the situation might be, how busy you might be, how pained it might be, it doesn't matter. Any of those things, we have access to God. We can commune with him. He calls us to it. We can commune with him. We can take all things, and lay them before the Father because we have access to God. A little bit later, it's going to be talking about the fact that we are the household of God. We are in the household of God. Let me ask you a question. How many people have free access into your house? I think about that once in a while. It's like, I got a son that lives in, boy, he lives, I don't know where he lives. He lives, right now he's with me. But most of the time he's in Alaska. And he'll be up there, and he'll work. And then all of a sudden, I'll get up some morning, And there he'll be at the table. So he decided to come home. And I haven't seen you in 3-4 months. How you doing? He said, yep, good. I got off work and I'm on my way. I made my way home last night. And I said, well, thanks for calling, you know. But the point is that he can sit at the table on an early morning when I get up to make coffee, and it doesn't matter. Why? Because he's a member of that household. So it doesn't matter who's coming and going. I get up and there's people there that are sleeping on the couch or they're over here. Whatever the case might be, they are all members of that household. And so there is no thought of why are you here? What are you doing here? I mean, I like you and everything, but why are you here? You're not a member of this household, you see. But with God, as a child of God, we are members of his household. Able to come to him day or night, no matter what the situation might be, no matter what the case might be, even if we've been neglecting him for the longest time, which most of us do, we can come back to him and say, Father, here I am. We have access now to God. Unlike before we were a child of God, back up there in verse 12, when it says that we are separated from Christ, we were excluded from the citizenship in Israel. We were foreigners to the covenants. We were without hope and without God. We had nothing. There was absolutely nothing. And God, in his grace and in his mercy, took that group, opened that door, and took the two and merged it together in what is now called the body of Christ. And because we have been reconciled to him, we now have access to God. We have access to God. One more thing before we go on. When you've been estranged from someone for a while, there's been tension. You left, and you know you should have said something. I should have called. I should have done something. And then the first time you come back together, it's a little bit tense. A little bit tense because you know that there's things that need to be said, but you're not really sure how to say them. And that's the way it's going to feel when you go back to God for the first time in a long time. Stay there. Stay there, for there he is. And he's like, talk to me. Talk to me. Tell me. It doesn't matter what it is. Tell me what it is. and you begin to share. And before you know it, you're walking through your the thoughts, and you're working through your prayers, and all the hurts, and all of the anxiety, and all of the stuff. And then the joys and the happinesses, and pretty soon you have this relationship with him again, so that you can't wait to get to a position where you can focus entirely on him. Having access to him now, you can't wait to get to him and share the things that are on your mind and on your heart. I can't wait to get to my truck every time I speed, because I know I'm going to get it. One way or the other, I know I'm going to get it, because I get in the truck, I start it up, and I take off, and I say, okay, God, I go back to verse 14, and and then he tells me what I did right, and he tells me what I did wrong, and we have this ongoing communication that is there that never stops, never stops. And if you find yourself not having anything to pray about, I don't know how you can do that. But if you ever find yourself not having things to pray about, go to a passage in the Word of God and begin to pray the passage. Not your thoughts on the passage. Begin praying the passage itself. The verses that are there. Talking to him about these things that it says right there. Where he talks about his purpose was to create in himself one new man. God, I don't understand all of those things. All I do know is that through the cross and through the blood that was shed on that cross, I now have a relationship with you. And so you're communicating. It's a two-way conversation that you're having there with God in his word. His purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace, and that peace you and I have. Now, that's what we used as the foundation. But now I want to begin looking at verse 19, and I want to see what these verses have to say to us here. There's just a couple of verses here that I want to look at carefully. It says, consequently, in other words, therefore. It's kind of a therefore. Consequently, as the result of all that I just said, as a result of all of this information I just gave you, it is brand new information. As a result of this information, consequently, he says, you are no longer foreigners and aliens. You are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household. That phrase there, God's people. In the King James, and I think probably a couple of King James only people in the crowd with us, and I really am. I love the King James. But the King James uses the word saint, okay? So you can replace God's people with that. And it says this, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. Let's just make one thing clear. That word saint's been kind of twisted over the years. A saint, according to the word of God, is someone who comes to Christ through faith in the shed blood on the cross of Calvary. That person, say it happens here today. Say there's someone in the room that comes to Christ here tonight. You are a saint, my friend. According to the word of God, you are a saint. Over the years, it's been made into something of someone who does this great deed. And there's a profound thing over here. And they are determined to be saints. That's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that we, as children of God, are saints. And so it tells us right here, no longer are you foreigners, no longer are you aliens, but you are now fellow members with all of God's people, all of the other Christians that are there, and members of the household of God. Built on the foundation. We sang about that. That was the last song that we sang. How great is that foundation that God has given to us, what? In his word. And that's exactly what he's talking about here, the apostle, as he's using this phrase. It says, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Now, if you were to go to chapter 4, right across the page for me, in verse 11, it says this. We're going to get to this in a couple of weeks. It says that it was he, that's the Lord Jesus, who gave some to be apostles and some to be prophets. Okay? He's talking about the foundation of the church of Jesus Christ. Now, with that in mind, not only the two words, but the order of those words, go back over to our passage in 2:19, or 2:20, where it says, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. The apostles, There were 13 of those apostles, okay? They were the disciples, and there was one that we know that betrayed the Lord Jesus. He was out, and Matthias took his place. That brings us to the number 12. And then we also know that in Acts chapter 9, God raised up a man named Saul of Tarsus and created the 13th apostle. When the Bible uses the words apostle here, that's exactly what they're talking about. Talking about that foundational office known as apostles of Christ. It was a foundational office only. It no longer exists. When the apostles were done, when they were gone, when they had died, the office of apostleship ended. Their job, very simply, was this. To lay the foundation with all the teaching, all the doctrine that is found in the Word of God. Their job was to lay that foundation. Their job was to receive and to declare the messages of God to the people that were in the church, and to prove or to empower, I should say, their message with signs, wonders, and miraculous gifts. The office of apostle is now closed. Technically, we could say that a lowercase a apostle still exists, simply someone who is sent, okay? Someone who is sent to a place with a message to give could, in a certain way, be called an apostle. But even then, we've taken that and we've messed with it to the point where now no one knows whether what's true or what's not true about the whole idea of apostleship. It was a foundational office that is now closed. Their job was to lay the foundation, to declare the will of God, and to prove it with the miraculous signs that God had given them the ability to do. And so the foundation that we are built on was laid by the apostles, and it says the prophets. Now the word prophets here, he's talking about New Testament prophets. He's not talking about the great men of the Old Testament here, okay? Which, in my estimation, are the greatest, most disturbing men that ever walked the earth. And anybody that's ever read the prophets, you know what I'm talking about. These guys were profound. I can't go a day without dipping into the prophets at one point or another. Everything that I want to know is found there. And I search, and I dig, and I try and figure out what's being said. I try and figure out what is being alluded to, what's being talked about here. And I pray over these guys. I pray over the message that God has given to them in order to proclaim God's word. Now, just a portion of it was actual foretelling. Just a portion of it was foretelling things that were going to happen. A vast majority of the messages that were given to the prophets is what is called forthtelling. Their message was, you got the law, you have all the things that God has given to you, you got everything, now move in that direction and stop moving in the direction that you're moving in now. They would forthtell the word of God. Percentage-wise, more so than they would foretell events that were going to happen in days and years to come. But New Testament prophets, they were raised up as well. And until the New Testament was written, until the New Testament as we know it was put together and completed, there were not only apostles, but there were prophets, New Testament prophets. I brought a book, and I want to give you a definition of the prophets. Now, this book is about the Old Testament prophets, the great, great prophets of the past. But the definition that he gives here in the introduction fits. Listen to what he says. And this is a man that spent his life devoted to the prophets of God. It says this. The prophet was an individual who said no to his society. Not just once in a while. Not just every now and again. The prophet was an individual who said no to his society. Condemning its habits. Condemning its assumptions. Condemning its complacency, condemning its waywardness, condemning its syncretism. That last word is one that we need to be very, very familiar with. What is syncretism? It's where you have something from the culture, something from the world over here, and we got something from God over here, and we mix the two a little bit in the middle. It is now in sync. And that's what people have done from the very beginning of time. And that's what Israel was doing. That's what the people of Judah were doing. And they could not stand, the prophets could not stand this whole thing called syncretism. Because you take something that's pagan, you take something that's heathen out here, and it doesn't matter whether you attach the name of God to it, whether we attach today the name of Jesus to it, if it is a mixture of two things, something from the world and the things of God, it is syncretism. And you have to know what the book says so that you can recognize syncretism when it comes. And ladies and gentlemen, it is absolutely everywhere. It is absolutely everywhere. You need to look carefully at the churches. You need to look carefully at the teachings that are there, and you will begin to see the synchronization of the things of the culture, the things of this world, and the things of God. Look for it. You won't have to look far, and you will find what that is. Prophets hated it. It says they condemned the syncretism that is there. It says that that he was often compelled to proclaim the very opposite of what his heart expected. In other words, when you look through Jeremiah talks about that. He says, I don't want to proclaim this message. It's a message of doom to my people. I don't want to proclaim that. I want to proclaim life. I want to proclaim joy. I want to proclaim happiness. That's what I want to proclaim. But the message, the burden that God put on him was one of wrath because of syncretism and disobedience. And so what they expected oftentimes is not what they were told to proclaim. It says that his fundamental objective was to reconcile man to God. Why do the two need reconciliation? Perhaps it is due to man's false sense of sovereignty, to his abuse of freedom, to his aggressive, sprawling pride, resenting God's involvement in human history. That's who the prophet was. And he would find these people, and he would go after these people. And make no mistake about it, the world resents more than anything else God's involvement on this planet. The world resents all of it, and they fight against it, they struggle against it. Psalm 2, the opening of Psalm 2, is absolutely true today as it was before. Why do the heathen rage? They rage because they know that God is in control. They know that God is there, that God is here, and that he is doing the things that he is going to do and that he alone can do. And they resent his involvement in history. That is a definition of the prophet, old or new. And so when it says the foundation that has been laid upon which we are built was built by the truths that were given to the apostles and the prophets from Jesus Christ himself. The teachings that were there, all the doctrinal statements that are made, these are the foundation upon which the building has been built. Those of you remember in 1 Corinthians 12, Paul's illustration was that of a body. And of all of the thousands and millions of different parts of the body, each one representing another member of the church, the body of Christ. Here, he's changing it from a body to a building. And it's saying that the foundation that is there is the truths that have been delivered to the apostles and prophets to lay that foundation. And upon that foundation, you and I, as little stones, are being built together. In which, it says, in which God will dwell by his Holy Spirit. Which means that the young person who comes to Christ today, the person who gives his life to God today, is now a stone in the building upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. And if that one stone is missing, that one stone is missing, the entire building is incomplete. How God loves his church. How God loves the people that make up the church, the body of Jesus Christ. One last thing and we're done here. It says that Jesus Christ himself, that the Lord Jesus himself is the chief cornerstone. For those of you, the cornerstone study is a beautiful study. but it was the stone that was laid, and it was laid perfectly in order to build upon it so that the building would be square and it would be true. And Jesus Christ himself, not only with his work upon the cross of Calvary, but with the teachings that he taught while alive and the revelations that he gave to the apostles after the resurrection and after the ascension, that makes up the cornerstone of the church of Jesus Christ. Just last night, late, as I was sitting in my chair, getting ready to turn in, I thought to myself, I wonder how the computer would define cornerstone. And so I took my phone and I typed it in. How would you define cornerstone? And this is what came up. It's fascinating. It says a cornerstone, a stone at the corner of a building uniting two intersecting walls. So it is a stone at the corner of a building intersecting two separate walls. And so when you think about that in the context of what we've been looking at from verses 11 to the end, with the unification of those two groups, this Gentile group and the group of Jews, and how God has pulled from that and created, how he has taken two intersecting walls and combined them, united them in himself, in Christ, to create the church, the body of Jesus Christ, in whom dwells God by his Spirit. Not only individually is the Spirit of God within you, but as a member of the church of Jesus Christ, as a member of that structure that was talked about here, God dwells in that structure by his Spirit. But now here's the thing. Verses like the truths like this that are now revealed to us, these are the motivation for us to go and do the things that God has given us to do. When we take the time, and most don't, but when we take the time to read and understand all that went into the creation of the Church of Jesus Christ, and how I, this lone member, becomes interconnected with the building materials over here in the church, the body of Christ, and how we are all interconnected there, and all that went into making that happen, the motivation and the warmth on the inside begins to stir, and I begin to move and do the things that God has called me to do. This is our motivation. This is the motivation to do the will of God. Nobody can make this up. None of the verses that we're looking at here could be made up by a human mind. We couldn't do it. The best that mankind can do is to create a religion that has the characteristics of mankind, but bigger. That's all it is. It's a man, a strong man, a big, strong, handsome man, and then bigger. That's all man can come up with. The truths that we're looking at here in this second chapter, they were not thought up in any way by any human mind. This is God putting together his plan of salvation for you and for me. Heavenly Father, we are grateful tonight to make up the church of your Son, Jesus Christ. What a joy it is. What a joy it is to be connected with all those other stones in this beautiful building in which you dwell by your Spirit. We're grateful for that, Father. Grateful for it. And I pray that we will contemplate what that is, that we will think about often what that means and what that is, and how that alone becomes the motivation for me to do the things that you have individually called me to do. Every one of us has a purpose. Every one of us has a job to do in that body. I pray that you will declare what that is in our minds and help us to achieve what you have called us to do. I thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your mercy to us. And I thank you for making me a part, a member of your household, the household of God. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Thank you.
Sparrows.
He doesn't blink. When God has his eye on you, never, never, ever blinks. And think about this. All the things that as we speak are slowly disappearing. Appreciation is on steroids in this culture. Things that are passing away. But we're sticking to things here that matter. Things that really count. And more than that, last. That chapter that Kevin referred to, 13 of 1 Corinthians. Now abide these three, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest is? And why? Why is that the greatest? Because eventually, we won't need faith. We live by faith now. We'd rather live by answers, but we live by faith. But when we go to glory, we're going to live by sight. By sight. Hope. We have hopes now. Our hope is in Christ. Hope. But when we're with Christ, we don't need hope anymore. But love. Love totally doesn't fail. It lasts. It lasts because it's the very essence of God himself. Remember that this week as we mingle with others and whoever that God puts into our life. Remember that the things we're talking about here are things that last. Thanks, you guys. That is JP, Susie, for the bar. We're glad. And even this is going to disappear. Did you know that's an appreciating black man? You're going down the toilet, kid. It's all going away. But the good stuff that you've centered on is hanging around like a fly of the picnic. So not going away. I love this place. Thanks for your singing. Thanks for your presence. Mingle. Bless you. See you next week. God bless you. Thank you.